Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Alternadad, the true story of one family's struggle to raise a cool kid in America, by Neal Pollack. Narrated by the author and directed by David Gassaway. This book is copyrighted 2007 by Neal Pollack. This recording is copyrighted 2007 by Recorded Books. The author opens this book with the following lines by Jean Havez, written in 1905. Everybody works but father, and he sits around all day, feet in front of the fire, smoking his pipe of clay. Mother takes in washing, so does Sister Anne. Everybody works at our house but my old man. And now, Alternadad.
Prologue. I was napping pleasantly on a futon one Saturday afternoon when my wife flung open the door. She held a filthy sponge in her left hand. A look of terrified desperation clouded her eyes. Catastrophe, she said. What? I said. Your son took off his diaper. He's throwing shit all over his bedroom. And he's enjoying himself. That's bad. It's disgusting, that's what it is. Now get out of bed and help me clean. I'd woken up with a kid who'd just turned 2 at 6:20 a.m., and I was tired. Plus, allergies had mashed my brains into lentil soup. They call it cedar fever here, which is an insult to cedars, and even to fever. It's horrible. My head was encased in a stack of hay. My eyes had been scraped dry. I needed a nap. No, I deserved a nap. But this situation required a dad. Damn it all to hell, I said, and I got up. Elijah stood in the middle of the living room. He was naked, flapping his arms, and hopping around like a Packers fan on Wild Card Sunday. Ah ha ha, he said. Elijah bad. Regina was in Elijah's room with a roll of paper towels and a bottle of industrial cleaner. She scrubbed the wall next to his bed with unrestrained fury. Elijah had thrown his blankies on the floor. Little chunks of poo corrupted all 3 of them. He smeared it all over the slats of his crib, Regina said. It's on his stuffed animals. It's everywhere. I really think I'm gonna puke. I see carrots. Oh, no. There are peas. And corn. She wasn't looking at me as she said that. I think she was speaking to some kind of abstract god of parenting. Then she turned to me with a command. Entertain him. Now. I looked at Elijah, who was cackling and turning in a circle. He didn't need to be entertained. He needed to be pacified. I turned on the TV. It was that Little Bear program where the Maurice Sendak created animated bears are such a happy family and they solve life's little problems, like getting lost in the woods or attacked by a puma, because their lives are based on sincere friendship and good judgment. Oh, how I loathe Little Bear. Regina emerged from the bedroom and pointed the sponge at me. Threat brewed in her gaze. You need to run him a bath. Right. She returned to the bedroom. I went into the bathroom and turned on the faucet. Elijah made a beeline down the hall. I grabbed him around the waist and twisted him upward. He howled with glee. Don't you dare, I said. Daddy, do, he said. He looked so cute. I just had to tickle him right then. Regina continued her attempts to contain the situation. She ordered me to put bubbles in his bath, even though I always put bubbles in his bath and wouldn't consider doing anything else. But I understood. Sometimes when matters spiral, you just need to control what you already know. By the time the bathtub was filled, the trauma of the afternoon had already waned. Regina had picked up all the larger poo chunks. She looked like a field surgeon 3 days after Antietam. All that remained was 2 loads of laundry. Do you want help? I asked. No, she sighed. Are you sure? Regina was the motor of my ambition, the bulwark of my soul, the apple of my eye, and the pearl of my heart. She handed me an afternoon's worth of our baby son's shit. Just get rid of this, she said. I took it, because I loved her. I walked outside. The wind nipped. I was wearing a white t-shirt, gray boxer briefs, and black socks pulled up to my knees. Also, I was holding a plastic Walgreens bag full of human excrement. A chill gust stopped me for a moment, and I had a premonition. Someday, I realized, I'll look like this all the time. Part 1. Before. Chapter 1. Positively Chase Avenue, 1993 to 1997. In the early 1990s, years before I became a father, I lived in a neighborhood called Rogers Park, on the far north side of Chicago. The neighborhood held a dozen blocks north to south that were lined with wide, shady trees. Thick-grained Lake Michigan beaches made up its eastern border. But despite its natural advantages, Rogers Park wasn't one of the fancier parts of Chicago. We didn't get the upscale retro diners, loft condos, or bars that catered to Indiana University graduates who seemed to spread throughout the city as if hatched from pods. Instead, the streets of Rogers Park dripped of mild neglect. This made them interesting, but not particularly dangerous. The apartment buildings in my neighborhood looked a little ragged, but you often heard guitars playing from inside them as you walked. No major trend had touched the neighborhood in decades. The people who lived there deliberately defied trendiness. The nightlife tried but failed. Hip-hop DJs, startup rock bands, and small independent film societies ran up against the same frustrations. No one in the neighborhood could afford to go out, unless they could, and then they went out in other neighborhoods. My cohabitants were poets and drunks, low-end shop owners and itinerant musicians, union organizers and shifty-eyed permanent graduate students who slept on the floor. At the time, I described the people of Rogers Park as the sediment left over after you put the city of Chicago through a sifter. It was a neighborhood for people who didn't belong in any other neighborhood. I lived on Chase Avenue, at the far northern end of the city, in a quasi-communal apartment with Riston, a female construction worker from rural North Carolina. We shared the apartment with a thin-fingered graduate student who possessed a bad temper and a cat whose name, Trockel, will be obscure except to those familiar with Norwegian philosophy. I had the room off the living room, which was separated from the rest of the apartment by a plywood wall painted with a mural depicting lush greenery that somehow also managed to be ugly. Previous residents of the apartment had constructed it during a drunken party, and it looked like something that amateurs slapped up during a weekend fundraiser at an elementary school. It included one nice feature, a window from which I could peek out onto the rest of the apartment like a guest star dropping in on Pee-wee's Playhouse. I got an actual window view as well, of a parking lot, and beyond that a concrete pier and a gray swirl of Lake Michigan surf. Riston was a hippie, albeit one who spent her nights reading Russian novels. She hung out with a loose coalition of assorted weirdos. Some of her friends even had children, or were in the process of making children, which I couldn't believe. Her best friend had a little daughter, about 4 or 5. The girl seemed perfectly happy. She ran around barefoot and dressed like a princess, as a little girl must. But she also colored and read books in a dingy cafe while her mom smoked cigarettes and did her own homework. Sure, my mom had gone to graduate school when I was a kid, and sure, she'd smoked a lot of cigarettes back when that was socially acceptable in the suburbs. But hanging out in a cafe? That was crazy. My parents only took us to Chinese restaurants. This little girl's parents attributed her conception to a bottle of wine, a lack of birth control, and a Hawkwind album. They lived in an apartment and were marginally employed. How, I wondered, could people like this possibly have kids? In Rogers Park, it seemed impossible to be any kind of parent other than an eccentric one. One couple I got to know, Brian and Sue Cozen, owned the No Exit Cafe, a place that had existed in several shades of brown since 1958, and practically screamed, Leo Kottke slept here. They raised 3 kids in a world of folk music, bad poetry, and men with food in their beards who played backgammon and go for money. I hung out with them from time to time because I liked them, but also because I had trouble believing they were real. I wanted to say, your parents? but you make your own jewelry and attend Native American coming-of-age ceremonies in South Dakota. It's not possible. My father is president of the Phoenix Rotary Club and eats hot dogs at Costco. That's what dads are supposed to do. I became friends with a guy named Lou, a Vietnam veteran and computer animation specialist in his early 50s who liked to drink, and had therefore met all the women in the neighborhood under 30 who went to bars. He threw Sunday potluck dinners at his condo, which he shared with a rotating roster of young roommates, a pit bull, and an utterly horrifying hairless 21-year-old cat. The dinners were like a halfway house version of Brigadoon. Every poet, freeloader, harmonica player, and semi-insane drug fiend in the neighborhood showed up, sometimes as many as 100 a week, only to disappear until the next dinner. This went on for years and eventually led to the cancellation of the dinners because Lou had a taste for the finer meats and couldn't afford the filchers anymore. I went nearly every week and filched as well, though I was one of the few people who at least brought a bottle of wine or a six-pack. Lou had two children, late teenage variety, that hung out at the potlucks. His daughter sang folk songs and played the guitar. His son dropped in and out of college and seemed to like to hang around his dad all the time. Then there was another son, a little red-haired kid who was 10 when I met him. Lou would drive to South Carolina every summer to fetch the kid from the kid's mother. He and the kid did a lot of normal things, like go to the beach and roller skate and play basketball. But the kid also spent a lot of time at restaurants, with bars, where Lou drank beer. Lou's flaws were obvious to anyone who was awake in his presence for more than 10 minutes, but he didn't seem like a worse parent, or a better one, than any other I'd known. It had never occurred to me that kids would choose to hang out with their parents. I would no sooner go out drinking with my dad than I would go skydiving with him. And while my folks had always been very generous about throwing parties, I really couldn't imagine them, or want them to consider, smoking pot with my friends. I grew up in high, upper-middle-class suburban Phoenix. When we moved there in 1977, my father was a marketing executive for a large corporate hotel chain. His employment situation and our material circumstances went up and down throughout my childhood. But we were never forced to abandon our house, which had an unobstructed view of Camelback Mountain and 2 adjacent acres of uncultivated desert brush. We had orange, lemon, grapefruit, and fig trees, a kidney-shaped swimming pool, and a cool, inviting back porch. I got my own shag-carpeted bedroom with built-in bookshelves, a desk, and corkboard. It was the size of an average Manhattan studio apartment, with a connecting bathroom that had a glass-stalled shower and saltillo tile floors. My parents planted us in a pretty exclusive neighborhood. My first Arizona playmate, a neighbor from down the road, was the heir to the Campbell's soup fortune. This was a land where parents were named Diane and Ted. They coached baseball, ran bake sales to raise money for the 8th-grade cheerleading squad, and had closets bigger than most people's garages. Several friends of mine practiced on personal tennis courts. On the other hand, the father of the kid whom I'd carpooled with to Hebrew school went to jail for some naughty legal work he did for Charles Keating. The dad of one of my co-editors on the high school paper suffered a similar fate for running a corrupt SNL. Those kinds of things never happened to parents in Rogers Park. I knew a young Rogers Park woman who'd worked in every cafe in the neighborhood. When I learned that she had a little daughter, it just seemed impossible. "But she sleeps with guys," I said to Riston.
"So?" Riston said.
"She has a kid."
"And what's your point?"
I really was that naive. But suddenly, parenthood no longer seemed like something exclusive to stable adults in boring suburbs. It seemed like everyone I knew suddenly had kids. Maybe, I thought, a guy like me could become a dad after all. About a year and 2 roommates after I moved in with Riston, her friend Ned came to live with us. Ned had a lot of problems. He got really depressed. Sometimes he thought that vampires were hovering outside the apartment and that they wanted to eat his brain while he slept, neither of which he could objectively prove. He wasn't capable of working a normal job or of waking up before noon, but he was quite sweet and funny, played bass reasonably well, and could draw brilliantly, though to no other end than filling sketchbook upon sketchbook. Ned was kind, almost guileless. He was also a dad. Years before, he'd gotten his high school girlfriend pregnant. She'd kept the baby, and he'd left town.
He knew his daughter, a little. Sometimes he'd visit his hometown for a week or two and come back with pictures of his smiling girl. He became the star exhibit in a museum of weird parenthood that existed only in my mind. When my parents came to visit, I liked to show him off, as if to say, "See? Not everyone lives in bourgeois comfort like you do." My mom, who'd spent much of her teenage life hanging out with actors in Greenwich Village, and my dad, who'd grown up in the Bronx with Jewish parents who'd left Germany, not by choice, in the mid-1930s, weren't impressed with the bohemian authenticity of my circumstances. I, on the other hand, looked at Ned as a piece of living, breathing outsider art and couldn't believe that my life had moved in such a fascinating direction or that it contained such original people. Somewhere along this important voyage of personal discovery, I got my own place. Riston moved back to North Carolina with a boyfriend. Ned became the senior resident of the apartment on Chase Avenue, which was by now so far removed from the original lessees that it had become a de facto squat. I started hearing stories. Hanging out at the No Exit Cafe, Ned met Jill, a sophomore journalism student from Northwestern, my alma mater. They drove around in her car all night, talking. For days they talked and talked, and then they were in love. I went over to the apartment for dinner one night, and it was a lot cleaner than it had been the last time. Jill had moved in. They got a little careless with the birth control. Jill wasn't feeling so good one evening. The next day, she and Ned took a bus to the doctor on Western Avenue, who told them the news. They went to a diner and gazed at each other over their favorite sandwich, which they shared because they could only afford one. The next time I saw Ned, he said, "Jill and I are having a baby." "Oh," I said, "that's great. I'm going to get a job." "Good for you. I want to be a real dad this time." "I think you'll be a wonderful dad." In reality, I had no idea because I didn't know what it meant to be a wonderful dad, or any kind of dad at all. Here were a college student and an unemployed mentally ill musician, and they were about to bring a child into the world. My head nearly exploded at the thought. I had to understand. One night, I went over to the apartment and sat them down. "I want to do a story about you guys," I said. Soon after moving to Rogers Park, I'd been hired as a reporter at a weekly alternative newspaper. It wasn't a typical job. I never had to go into the office unless I wanted to, and I usually didn't want to. My editors gave me few deadlines and even fewer assignments. I was completely free. On days when I didn't have anything else to do, which were frequent, I'd hop the L and ride it to a stop I'd never visited before. I covered whole wards with my notebook and tape recorder, hanging out in taverns and junkyards, on piss-stained Lake Michigan piers, and in strangers' basements. Every experience seemed important and precious. I conducted four-hour interviews with coffee house owners and popcorn stand proprietors, and played beach volleyball with drag queens. Among my friends, I counted a Colombian cab driver, a Korean liquor store owner, a flamboyantly gay black barbecue entrepreneur, and an 80-year-old former exotic dancer who illegally sold used furniture from her front yard in the shadow of Wrigley Field. But I wanted to write a story that, to me, exemplified the neighborhood I called home. Ned and Jill were it. I approached my editor with the story idea. "It's about hippies having kids," I said. My editor wasn't impressed. She had two children herself. Birth held no mystery for her. "No, really," I said, "it's a good story. It's emblematic of the culture of the neighborhood." Every editor has his or her weak spots, and writers who don't want to work very hard need to discover those weak spots if they want to survive. I'd hit on one of her tics. My paper, like many urban weeklies, specialized in amateur anthropology, and I was a leading practitioner. "All right," she said, "but keep me updated." That meant, "Call me in 3 months." "No problem," I said. I went to the doctor with Ned and Jill. We got a sonogram. Jill and I went shopping for vitamins. Once a week, I attended birthing classes, which were conducted on soft pillows in the den of a late 19th century house in Evanston, owned by a young, good-looking couple to whom the Clinton years had obviously been kind. We sat for hours in Ned and Jill's apartment talking about their dreams and possible baby names. Jill would go to school part-time and also work part-time. Ned would work part-time, too, and take care of the baby when Jill was busy.
He really wanted to be a hands-on dad. Theirs, they thought, was the perfect setup. It was hard for me to keep a repertorial distance, so I got excited along with them. I felt a little bit like a member of the third gender and stranger in a strange land, though I hate it when people use the verb to grok. Around the 8th month, I declared myself on call at all times. If Jill had even a twinge of labor, she and Ned needed to call me. They'd agreed to allow me into the birthing suite, and I wasn't about to miss that show. Twice I roared out of the house, interrupting sleep and even Jeopardy, and I would have been at the hospital within 5 minutes if I'd had a car. Instead, it was 30 minutes on the L, including a transfer at Belmont to the Brown Line. Both times, the labor didn't take, and it was back to long walks by the lake for Ned and Jill to jar that little sucker loose. One night, I came home drunk to find the message on the answering machine. Jill's water had broken. They were hanging out at a friend's house until labor progressed to the point where they needed to go to the hospital. Someone would call me at the appropriate hour. Though I didn't witness this myself, intrepid background reporting later revealed that Ned lay on his side next to Jill, rubbing her back and whispering supportive things to her. Finally, around dawn, it was time. The friend drove them to the hospital down Lakeshore Drive, in a car without shock absorbers. Jill didn't enjoy this drive much. At 6 a.m., the phone rang. It was Jill's friend. They needed a reporter post-haste to witness the birth. This time I avoided risk. $10 and I part hard, but I took a cab and got there in time. The lights were dim and the room felt calm, as homey as things get in a hospital. It was quiet and sanctified, almost like they'd piped in the silence. I smelled disinfectant. Jill lay on a queen-size bed that looked warm and relaxing. Ned lay behind her, forever rubbing her back. I was tired and still pretty drunk. I turned on my tape recorder, because it's important to capture the audio squish of the birth canal for a newspaper article. "Hi, Neal," Jill said. "Shh," I said, as I sat in a chair that would place me in the same relative proximity to the birth as an umpire has to a cleanup hitter. "Pretend like I'm not here." Jill had determined that she'd do the birth without any painkillers unless it was really necessary, with the meaning of necessary very much up to her discretion. Impressively, she endured. The midwife came in at crunch time. Jill pushed. Her vagina opened like a flower in a stop-motion nature video. She let out a throaty moan, and a boy emerged from her womb. I got out of there quickly. Any tears shed between Ned and Jill in the next hours weren't my business until they told me about them later. I found myself shaking and profoundly moved. It was like I'd seen a Faces of Death video, but in reverse. Reproduction was magic, and the birth had been flawless. Someday, I thought, when I have a child, it will go exactly like that. A couple weeks later, I turned in my story with the happy ending I'd witnessed. My editor rejected it. "Something about this feels false to me," she said. I murmured something like, "You're such a bitch, bitch, bitch," in my mind. 3 months of work. 3 months. I was an artist. Didn't she understand? But she was right. Birth is just the opening scene of a more complicated, more difficult, and far more interesting story. Time passed without me seeing much of Ned and Jill. Neighborhood bars were shutting down all over Chicago, and I'd made it my professional duty to attend the closing nights of as many of them as I could. But things rarely shut down in Rogers Park, or if they did, not too many people cared. So I spent a lot of time away from the neighborhood. About 6 months after the birth, I ran into Jill at the No Exit. She'd returned to school with much success, but was having a lot of trouble finding someone to take care of the kid. Ned certainly didn't help. He'd decided that he needed to spend a lot of time at band practice in the suburbs. On a good day, Ned was home from noon to five. Sometimes he'd stroll the baby down the street to a coffee house and flirt with the girls who admired his sensitive fathering manner. Jill had an important 3-hour class one evening, and she couldn't find anyone to take the kid. By 4:30, Ned still hadn't shown up, and she was getting worried. 5 passed, then 6. The class started at 7. Ned came home after 8, and she was done with him. At the end of the semester, after she'd graduated from the best journalism school in the country with honors while caring for an infant full-time,
Jill took the baby to visit her father in Montana. She didn't come back. A few months later, Ned went out to visit them. He really wanted to see the kid. So he did, staying there for a little while. Then he returned to Chicago, but not for long because he couldn't pay rent on the apartment anymore. He was going back to his hometown to live with his mother. "I want to see my daughter," he said to me the last time I saw him. I'd realized that, regardless of a family's financial circumstances, there are good parents and bad parents, and a whole bunch of possibilities in between. Aesthetics mattered a little bit, but they weren't all that mattered. Eccentricity is not a virtue unto itself. I resolved to apply this knowledge on the off chance that I ever became a dad. Unfortunately, I've never been good at remembering what I've learned. For a while, I stayed in touch with Jill. She got a job at a newspaper and found a good school for her son. There were wide open spaces and goats, and she had family nearby. She moved in with a grown-up man. Once in a while, she sent along pictures of the boy, who was handsome and healthy. But I felt an odd disconnect between that child and the one I'd seen born. I changed my email address and forgot to CC Jill on the announcement. I still lived in Rogers Park, but the neighborhood's mystique had begun to recede from my life. It had helped foster a self-perception that I was a lonely poet of the city, destined to forever walk Chicago's icy winter streets under flickering yellow street lamps. But a guy's self-perception can change, particularly when he meets a girl. Chapter 2. Love. Exciting and New. 1997 to 2000. In those years, my love life was extremely annoying, both to me and to everyone I knew. An affair with a beautiful and mysterious young woman collapsed when the ghost of her dead policeman father told the family that he didn't approve of me. That was, admittedly, the most extreme case, but my other entanglements didn't trail by much. I picked up the owner of a used bookstore coffee bar, who took me to a party where she alternated between kissing me and a guy in drag. I had a lot of sex with a very nice schoolteacher, but only, at our mutual insistence, during the half times of televised Bulls games. I ended a tete-a-tete with a contraceptive educator because I hated her poetry. A brief instant message and phone affair with a Boston-area woman provided some solace until she dumped her husband and moved in with a female nurse. I fell very much in love with a young sculptor who had a chronic back problem, but I had a girlfriend at the time. When I emerged single, the sculptor had latched onto a roadie for Poi Dog Pondering. It was a typical, or maybe hyper-typical, catalog of moronic romantic missteps for a 27-year-old man. My friends endured a lot of, "But I just want to find someone who loves me for who I am, not for who they want me to be," though I had no idea what that meant. One Thursday afternoon, I checked out the personal section of my newspaper. This was before the era of Friendster and Nerve Personals and Craigslist. Hooking up with other sexually frustrated neurotics took more than a few emails and a quick subway ride. Surprise was still possible. "Wayward Southern Belle," went the ad of the week. "Seeks single gentleman with penchant for scatological humor." Not only did I want to respond to the ad, but I also got phone calls from several female friends telling me that I had to get in touch with this woman immediately. She sounded like I'd made her to order. Many of my favorite women are Southern and a little naughty. In addition to being the sexiest things on the planet, they have manners. They also like to boss people around, and I needed bossing. So I called the personals number, which cost me 99 cents a minute, despite my years of service to the company, and punched up her mailbox. A few days later, I stood on the top step of the Film Center of the Art Institute of Chicago, which has since moved downtown and been renamed after Gene Siskel. I'd made the obvious first date choice of a 6 p.m. screening of The Tarnished Angels, a 1958 Douglas Sirk movie about stunt flyers starring Rock Hudson and Robert Stack. Mainstream movies at corporate movie theaters, unless Quentin Tarantino directed them, were simply out of the question for me in those years, but I never missed a showing of Funny Face at the Music Box. Regina had said she might be late because she was working for a mural painting company and they had a job out in the suburbs. She showed up with her hair drawn back, and she was wearing a nice skirt and blouse number and knee-high black boots. Cute, I thought. Not just cute for someone I met through a personal ad, but objectively cute. "Hi," I said.
Hi, she said.
You're late.
I told you.
Well, you're really late, I said. You made me miss the first 5 minutes.
We were married already.
After the movie, we went to an Italian restaurant in Wicker Park that isn't there anymore. She drove because I didn't have a car. I ate a lot of pasta way too fast. Midway through the meal, I excused myself. I spent the day on a rooftop in the hot sun, interviewing an eccentric Chicano art collector. He'd poured me a few liberal helpings of vodka with not too much cranberry juice to cut it. That night, the heat and the vodka took their revenge. I returned to the table.
Are you okay? She said.
Oh, I'm fine.
You were gone a long time.
Do you have any gum?
She did, fortunately. We talked of art and books and music and food and life, all of which we said we loved. The conversation flowed without pause or disagreement. Soon it turned to childhood. She'd grown up in Nashville, under economic circumstances more or less similar to mine. She'd attended the same private girls' school as Reese Witherspoon, and her manners were just as good. We also had a Phoenix connection. Her aunt and uncle had lived within walking distance of my grade school. While I really don't like Phoenix, because no sane person does, it still gave us an extra thing in common. There were also important differences. I'm adopted, she said.
Oh.
I was in a foster home for a year, and then my parents came and got me.
Do you know anything about your birth parents?
I was born in Knoxville. My mom says my birth mom was a cheerleader at the University of Tennessee. I don't have any more information.
That must be hard.
It's like there's this gap in my identity. I don't know who my people are. That's why I'd really like to have children, because I need something to biologically call my own. Some sort of physical connection to the world.
A short but meaningful pause later, she asked,
So what do you think about kids?
Oh, I love kids, I said. I always have. I'm really good with them.
The question hadn't bothered me or put me off, and I really didn't think about why she looked excessively pleased at my response. I was just excited to be having dinner with a woman who didn't seem to care that I was nerdy. In fact, she snorted rather easily at my jokes and had a Jean-Luc Picard figurine on her dashboard, so she didn't have any nerdiness leverage on me. She was exactly the woman I'd been searching for, a smart, confident, talented, patient, bossy, good-looking southern nerd. It was getting late, but I proposed that we become even drunker. On the way back to my place, we stopped at a bar called the Great Beer Palace, which also isn't there anymore. My stomach gave out on me anew.
Could you please excuse me again, I said.
After I was done regurgitating the rest of my dinner, I really needed some gum. I asked her to stop at a White Hen pantry on the way home. All the while, I talked to her about how I didn't believe in monogamy. At the time, I was under the influence of left-wing friends who spent a lot of time decrying the bourgeois constrictions of contemporary heterosexual relationships. Why should we be restricted to just one partner? I said to my future wife.
We just should.
That's very conventional of you to think so. I chomped on my gum. She pulled up to my apartment building. I leaned toward her, tongue ablazing. A few minutes later, we unclenched. That had been some pretty great smooching. I desperately wanted to see her again. A week later, we met at a bar. I was there first. In fact, I'd been there all day, or at least since 3:30, when Jeopardy aired in Chicago. Again, she arrived about 5 minutes late. Sorry if I stink, she said. I went for a run and didn't take a shower.
That's okay.
I tried to kiss her.
I don't think it's going to work out, she said.
To recap, on the night I met Regina, I nagged her because she was late to a movie, vomited twice without telling her, and then made out with her for a while, and went on a long, ill-considered rant about how I don't believe in monogamy.
Why? I said.
After a drink, she agreed to drive me home. I pressed my case because I'd decided I was in love with her, though I didn't admit that out loud because it's generally not a good idea to tell a woman you're in love with her while she's breaking up with you.
But you don't believe in monogamy, she said.
Oh, come on, do you really think I meant that?
Why wouldn't I?
My belief felt genuine, at least abstractly, but here I found myself confronted with someone who I already knew I wanted to marry.
She was sweet, kind, warm, practical, and fun. From our conversations, if not actual experience, she had no sexual neuroses and seemed to enjoy sex a lot. I'd never met a sexually confident woman who seemed able to deal with my irrational mood swings. While these two qualities don't necessarily have anything to do with each other, it was still a new combination for me. I got excited. My favorite movie is Airplane. I knew all the lyrics to the original Broadway soundtrack of Annie, and my first rock concert was the Huey Lewis and the News Sports Tour in 1983. And she didn't care. She owned a dozen Kate Bush records and even more Lyle Lovett albums. And I didn't care either. I couldn't imagine losing Regina, even after just one date. I've always tended to fall in love quickly and dramatically, so it was time for me to get drastic. I'd recently seen the Baz Luhrmann directed Romeo and Juliet and had found it quite moving. Just like Leonardo DiCaprio, I raised my hands above my head. "I am fortune's fool," I shouted. Regina looked genuinely worried, possibly because she didn't get the reference right away. "No, you're not," she said. "I am, I am, I am fortune's fool." 3 weeks passed, and I thought about her often. In fact, I called her 20 times a day. I did this out of enthusiasm rather than obsession, though I guess the line between the two depends on whether or not you're making or receiving the calls. In retrospect, our son owes his existence to the fact that Regina didn't have caller ID, voicemail, or an answering machine. It also helped that her other current boyfriend was an accountant, whose dominant trait seemed to be his desire to hide his frequent marijuana use from her. Over the 4th of July weekend, while visiting friends in St. Louis, she realized that I was, in fact, the better option. Perhaps I was even the best option in the whole world. I had already promised that I'd never hide my frequent marijuana use from her. We arranged to meet at a club called Shuba's, where a band called the Handsome Family was playing on a Friday night. The Handsome Family are a married couple who for many years have taken various mental problems and dark obsessions and spun them into lyrical, haunting songs reminiscent of Nick Cave, Vic Chestnut, and the Leuven Brothers. They're based elsewhere now, but at the time they lived in Chicago. They liked a vacation in the Wisconsin Dells and sang incessantly about suicide, making them a popular model for every Chicago couple with a vaguely alternative bent. Regina and I more closely resemble the family on Seventh Heaven than the Handsome Family, but we liked the band regardless. I don't remember the name of the opening band, but I do remember that they hung piñatas above them on the stage. One piñata in particular, a roundish pink ghost with puckered lips, caught Regina's attention. "That's Pinky," she said. "I love Pinky. He's pretty cute." She put her head in my lap and gave me a goofy smile. "Hi," she said. "Well, hello there," I said. All night, possibly to the Handsome Family's annoyance, Regina and I crooked our pinky fingers at each other and squealed, "Pinky! Ooh! Pinky!" I went up to the lead singer of the opening band after the show and asked him how much money he wanted for Pinky. He said that Pinky wasn't for sale. We were disappointed, but I suddenly wanted to do something very nice for Regina. The next time she and I got together, she saw my apartment for the first time, just for a few minutes. As we were getting ready to leave, I said, "Do you hear that noise? It's really strange." "What noise?" she said. "Just a noise," I said. "Sounds like someone trying to get out of somewhere. Where could it be coming from?" She began to look nervous. "Wait," I said. "I think it's coming from this closet over here." I opened the door to my coat closet. A yellow papier-mâché giraffe hung from the ceiling. I'd bought it earlier that day at a Mexican grocery store. "Look at that," I said. "I think he's saying he wants to go home with you." "You got me a piñata," she said. It chose me. Soon thereafter, we began to spend the night at each other's places. I preferred mine. It was large and relatively quiet. Furthermore, I had a brand new queen-size bed of medium quality, while Regina slept on an uncomfortable futon with a dream catcher hanging overhead. She had a roommate who was going through some depression and had begun to exhibit jealous symptoms toward me. Also, an elderly German brother and sister lived below them, and at any manifestation of noise after 10 p.m., the brother, Gunther, would come up the stairs, pound on the door, and moan, "Please, I am desperate for sleep!" Who needed that crap? Also, Regina and her roommate got into some weird psychological battle about garbage. They'd leave bags festering for weeks on their back porch until finally, with a heaving sigh of frustration, I'd lug them away, saying something endearing like, "You guys are such fucking slobs." And then there was Growl Tigger. Regina owned two male gray tabby cats, both of which weighed more than 20 pounds. One of them, which she'd pretentiously named Tea Cake after the male lead in Zora Neale Hurston's Their Eyes Were Watching God, was harmless enough if you kept him fed and allowed him to drink out of the bathtub faucet at all times. The other, Growl Tigger, was one of those special needs pets that can turn the hardiest female soul into a crazy cat lady. Tea Cake was a big cat, but he wore his weight well, almost like a puma would. Growl Tigger, on the other hand, was just fat. A great sack of blubbered fur hung from his belly, spreading like pond ripples wherever he lay. He slept with Regina, and I don't just mean on the bed. Every night around 11 p.m., Growl Tigger would curl himself around Regina's head, place his paw on her cheek, and begin purring lustily. More than once, I woke to see the two of them nuzzling like lovers. Finally, I called her on it. "Are you making out with Growl Tigger?" "No," but she blushed. "Look, he's a sweet cat, but would you please stop kissing him? It's freaking me out." Growl Tigger made an unreliable bedmate. Occasionally at dawn, he'd stand up and secrete a foul-smelling, viscous white liquid from his anal glands. Because Growl Tigger slept so close to Regina, sometimes her hair bore the burden of his leakage. She called this process getting assed. It smelled exactly like you might think, but much worse. I know this because she occasionally put her hair under my nostrils after it happened so I could share in the experience. Once, after one of the rare nights we spent apart, I got a call long before my usual wake-up time of 10 a.m. "Oh, no," Regina said. "What? You're not going to believe it." "Just tell me." "Growl Tigger assed in my nose." "Come on. I woke up and he was standing on my chest. I saw it coming out of his butt, but I couldn't stop him." She sounded generally miserable, but I suspected she'd enjoyed it, albeit so subconsciously that even her subconscious wasn't aware. "I'm sorry," I said. "I've washed inside my nose 3 times, she said, "and it still smells like ass." After 6 months or so, we moved in together despite Growl Tigger's ass problem. Our new home was a really nice 3-bedroom, 2-bathroom, 1 block away from Hollywood Beach. It had a 2-person tub with massage jets, front and back porches, and rent low enough to make everyone jealous. The cats joined us. In addition to Tea Cake and Growl Tigger, I had 2 female cats, Gabby and Zimmy, who themselves weren't exactly hot fudge Sundays. Gabby is skeletal, whiny, and affectionate to the point of obsession. She'll live for a long time because she can lithely jump to a high place very quickly from a standing start. But poor little Zimmy was a fluffy, unathletic, long-haired, gray and white, fragile princess cat. Growl Tigger, the kind of cat that intentionally knocks over a vase if you're not paying attention to him, swatted her on the head every time he saw her. Zimmy spent most of the rest of her time with us, under the bed. With such troublesome animals in our lives, Regina and I needed to escape relatively often. We took a short vacation to the Wisconsin-Iowa border, where no cat could ass us. Regina brought her banjo. She'd recently expressed interest in learning how to play, so I'd bought her a used one for her 30th birthday. The banjo didn't come out of its case the entire trip, but she took it everywhere nonetheless. The fact that she'd even considered playing the banjo on a hike in Wisconsin merely confirmed that I'd chosen my partner well. On our way back home, we spent the night in Galena, Illinois, a Midwestern town that reflects our nation's deep nostalgia for the glory days of the Rutherford B. Hayes presidency. Regina and I went to see a Mark Twain impersonator who was always in residence and dined on poorly sauced food under faux gaslit chandeliers. For some reason, this cheap 1880s theme park setting inspired one of the most important conversations of our lives. We walked along the Mississippi, oblivious to the camera-snapping tourists around us. "I really hope I can make a living as a fiction writer someday," I said. "I've never wanted to do anything else." "I wish my painting could support me," she said, "but there's no way." "That's the most important thing," I said. to support yourself doing what you love. I'm going to live by that principle, no matter what.
Yeah, she said.
There are innumerable reasons, good and bad, why people choose to get married. Some marriages are bound together by sexual passion, while others more closely resemble platonic friendship or a business deal. Ours contained elements of all three. Regina and I looked at each other and held hands. At that moment, though we didn't say anything, we knew that we had sealed the eternal bond, forever declaring that, unto death, our mutual love was to be the agent of our fondest individual artistic dreams. We would never allow the other to fail. The night we returned home to Chicago, we got naked and lay in bed.
I think we should get married, I said.
Is this it? Regina said.
Yep.
Oh, baby. And then we kissed.
This stands as the third happiest moment of my life, behind only the birth of my son, which was still more than 3 years away, and Kirk Gibson's game-winning home run in Game 1 of the 1988 World Series. I would have placed my engagement second, but as soon as we were done kissing, Regina called her mother. That knocked it down one place on the list, but it was still definitely above Game 5 of the 1993 NBA Finals. The next night, as Regina and I relaxed in the dining room, I took a sip of scotch and said, casually, "Our life is pretty great right now. I don't know if I want to have kids." A thick rain began to fall outside. Our windows slicked with a torrent. Agonized lightning flashes mixed with organ peals of thunder. The wind called the lost ships of Lake Michigan home from the deep.
"What do you mean?" she said.
I don't want to have kids, maybe? There's no way for me to write Regina's response without it sounding like dialogue from The Young and the Restless, so instead indulge me while I invoke the spirit of William Shakespeare, one of the few writers capable of registering the intensity of her response. "Husband, show your false self no more before my wet-veiled eyes. Thine fickle promises are cast upon the rocky shores of hope. Oh, castle of barren desire, I plead mercy on this forsaken womb."
Maybe I do want to have kids.
She sniffled.
"Are you sure?" she said.
"Oh yes," I said. "Very sure." Chapter 3. The Nest Tightens. June 2000 to December 2001. About a month after we returned from our honeymoon, Regina took a trip to visit some friends of ours who'd just moved to Narberth, a hilly, verdant, close-in suburb of Philadelphia, a place with a neighborhood bar on Main Street and a 100-year-old independently owned general store. From that cozy launching pad, our friends took Regina on forays into the city, showing her Philly's rich, weird outdoor market culture and outstanding art museum. In the evenings, they supped with interesting people of substance at a certain income level. Regina called me.
"You need to take a serious look at this place," she said.
2 months later, I did. Our friends showed me the same things they'd shown Regina. The old neighborhoods with small streets, the food carts, and the Reading Terminal Market, where I ate a roast turkey sandwich with gravy at an Amish diner. On my own, I discovered bars full of smoke and original wood, places with surly bartenders, bad jukeboxes, and unappealing clientele. One morning, we went to the Italian market in South Philly and saw vegetable vendors warming their hands over trash can fires in the middle of the street. Then, on a drive through the neighborhood just north of the art museum, I spotted a kid in a Phillies cap bouncing a ball repeatedly against his stoop like he was one of the Ducky Boys in The Wanderers, just waiting for his chick to call him on a Saturday night. That kid with the ball made something bloom in my heart. I'd been growing disenchanted with Chicago. All the things that I loved about the city, the diversity, the weirdness, the old buildings, seemed to be disappearing. The incessant gentrification and the incessant bitterness of the people like me who tried to prevent or at least limit it had begun to wear on me. For many years, I'd romanticized what I thought was the old Chicago, a weird, dirty, corrupt machine town where downtown was sleazy and junkies owned the nightlife district. Of course, I'd spent the best years of the 70s watching television in suburban Phoenix, and therefore I had a limited perspective. An old neighborhood Paul I knew once told me, "You know, things weren't so great here in the 1970s. But I wasn't listening. Perhaps I'd written too many stories about people and businesses getting displaced by real estate development,
Or perhaps I was an idiot. Regardless, I was in the middle of a city that felt more generic to me every day. I needed a break. Regina and I sat up late trying to gather the courage to relocate. I loved my newspaper job, but the work had begun to feel repetitive to me. I really wanted to write fiction. A few years close to New York, I figured, would help me find an agent and maybe get a book deal. Regina wanted to paint, but her space in our apartment was a badly lit, skinny room that overlooked a busy street. In Chicago, it was too expensive for her to rent a space outside the house, but in relatively ungentrified Philly, there were lots of abandoned industrial buildings that were renting out raw spaces to artists before the loft developers descended. Our decision got a lot easier when Regina received a small inheritance from the estate of her father, who died the year before she and I had met. We wanted to buy property with the money. It wouldn't have landed us a small studio in the least desirable neighborhood in New York, but it was just enough to get a little house in Philly, one of the few affordable East Coast cities left. We had very little to lose by moving there. But the main reason I wanted to live in Philly was that it still felt old and was still really strange. It was what I imagined Chicago had been like in the 1970s. That may be the least reasonable motivation ever for moving to a place, but it's genuinely what I believed at the time. Philly, people said. Why are you moving there? Or, if they were already living in Philly, they said, why are you moving here? If we didn't feel like getting weird looks, Regina would say something like, well, Neal really needs to be closer to New York for his work, and plus it's cheap, so I might be able to afford a studio. But the real reason, at least the one in my mind, came out sometimes anyway. I'd say, because we saw a fishmonger warming himself over a garbage can fire in the middle of the street. We house hunted in mid-August, during the Republican National Convention. I thought, for some reason, that I was covering the convention and its associated protests for Rolling Stone, so I spent many useless hours witnessing the usual melodramatic scene of the police doing battle with radical left-wing puppeteers. As the tear gas canisters exploded, Regina was calling me with real estate updates. I kept telling her to call me back after the people's struggle was over. Didn't she understand that democracy was at stake here? Then I got chased down an alley by some motorcycle cops, and I decided that house hunting might not be such a bad alternative. To help us find our Philadelphia dream home, we engaged a kind and sophisticated realtor named Ingrid, who charmed us with a client newsletter that described all the fine books she'd read recently. Ingrid immediately deduced that Regina and I could afford a house in a neighborhood in the middle stage of its urban pioneer period. She showed us several places out of our league just to whet our appetites, and a couple of really nice buildings in the middle of blocks that otherwise looked like London after the Blitz. Then she took us down Poplar Avenue, a minor thoroughfare at the northern edge of central Philly. We beheld a dumpy little townhouse on a block of dumpy little townhouses. The house Ingrid showed us had cracked, bulging sidewalks, wainscoting with peeling dark green paint, and brick that, because of deteriorating mortar, looked as though it had been pared down with sandpaper. Not very promising, we all agreed. Inside was a different matter. The paint colors were a little off, but the house had some charming original cabinets, a cool decorative fireplace, and a nice seat in the bay window, which would be perfect for pillows, on which our cats could then pee. Upstairs were a nice big bedroom with a skylight and large built-in closet, an extra bedroom with a built-in cedar wardrobe that had once been utilitarian, but was now nearly an object of art, and a small bathroom with low-quality Mexican-style tile. The big winner, however, was the kitchen, large, with a cork floor, an island, and funky red cabinets that wrapped around the room. Regina and I began to act impressed. This is a nice house, Ingrid said, matter-of-factly, almost surprised. A middle-aged Jewish couple occupied it. She was a sculptor who taught pottery classes. He was a record producer who'd been instrumental in developing the Philly soul sound of the 60s and currently did work with the Roots. They'd raised one daughter and a couple of golden retrievers in that little place. We felt as though we'd be buying the house from an older version of ourselves. Our housing philosophy, which has remained consistent over the years, was move into a house only if the people living there before you had the same income level or above. This often lands us in a pretty nice house in a pretty sketchy neighborhood. It had been relatively easy to avoid real estate hypocrisy when I was a single guy renting an apartment. But homeownership, especially homeownership with a $712 monthly mortgage, muddied the political waters. For someone who didn't like gentrification, I was certainly spending a lot of time gentrifying. The possibility of profit had joined the equation, but my old priorities lingered. We went out back to the tiny patio, which was occupied mostly by plant boxes, raccoon turds, and shards of broken pottery. I saw that one plant off in a corner had a familiar if illegal-looking leaf. Leaning in, I took a sniff. My nose never fails me in such matters. "We'll take it," I said. Growltigger wasn't well. He developed a heart murmur. As we prepared for our move in the fall of 2000, he began to have breathing problems. Regina took him to the vet, who told her that the cat's heart had enlarged. Medication kept him comfortable for a while, but gradually he turned listless and surly. He lay in the middle of the living room, heaving. Regina fell to the floor.
"I love him so much."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.